Andrew Michal. I was a grad student at UC Berkeley for a while.
All right. So I started the EndBlend project about 5 years ago. I was interested in making panoramic photography, and there was a tool missing in the tool flow. There's Hugin already available, which helps you line up your images, and it does all the image warping that you need. It does all the lens corrections, various things like that, and it outputs all these great images like this, and it tells you what the relative XY offsets are supposed to be for them, and that's all encoded in the file metadata. And what you really need is a way to merge all these files down into one output image. And you want to do that in a way so that you can't see the seams in between any of the images. So I wrote this tool called EndBlend, which is designed to do that. It takes all these images, which have, they're all lined up already. They have XY coordinates in them, and it produces a nice output where you can't see where the images cross over between each other. And the EndFuse tool is a separate tool that came on a little bit later. And this does something a little bit different. It still has the idea that I'm going to merge a bunch of images together so you can't see where one image starts and the other image ends, except instead of overlapping sort of in a horizontal way, we have images that overlap basically exactly on top of each other. And what it's doing is it's picking the good pixels from each of these images and taking the good pixels and putting them together into the output. So in this case, real estate photographers like this a lot because you normally take a picture of the inside of a room and you can't see anything outside. It's too bright out there. So this is similar to an HDR type workflow, but it's not exactly the same. It's not doing any fancy radiance maps or tone mapping algorithms or anything like that. It's basically saying, I want the good pixels from this image and the good pixels from this image and the good pixels from this image, and just making it so you can't really tell where one image starts and the other image stops in the output. Okay, so how do these tools work? I'm gonna go into some technical details about what these tools do and then some of the interesting coding tricks to make them work fast. Okay, so the basic idea is that you have a pair of images and you wanna blend them together. So there's some arbitrary overlap and some overlap region. And essentially what this does is it's coming up with a blending function that you want to apply, which sits on top of the overlap region. And basically this says that in the places where the blending function is white, the green image has 100% priority, and in places where the blending mask here is black, then the red image has 100% priority, and you have some nice smooth gradient across the overlap region between the two, and you end up with a nice blend that you can't see. So the goal, of course, would be to make this transition function nice and smooth. So here's an example of why you need to do that. So here's some Patagonia pictures, and the one on the right is a little bit too dark, and the one on the left is a little bit too light. And so if you just put them on top of each other with a not very good blending function, you will obviously be able to see the seam between the two, and it doesn't look so good. So you want to use a nice, wide, smooth blending function. And if you do that, you can basically erase the discontinuity entirely, and it makes a nice picture, and you can't really tell where one image starts and the other image stops. So this gets a little trickier than this. If you look really closely at this, you'll see that there's actually a problem in it. If you zoom in to this spot sort of in the middle here, you can see that the nice wide blending function left some artifacts in the image. This happened because the mountain didn't exactly overlap with itself between the two pictures. You know, there's always some minor errors that show up. And so by simply blending across them, you can see these kind of goofy looking ghosting artifacts, where you have basically two copies of the same thing, which are offset by a little bit, and they both kind of show through. So the thing that EndBlend does to fix this is it uses a slightly different technique called multi-resolution blending. And this is from a paper, which is actually quite old by now, and the major observation that Burton Adelson made was that you want to use different size transition masks based on what the components of the images look like. So for things that are nice and smooth, like the sky, that's something that has low spatial frequency. And so if you have a narrow transition region for big smooth objects, it's going to be immediately obvious. Your brain expects the sky to be nice and smooth, and if it's not by even just a little bit, it stands out right away as being a problem. And for areas like this, where you have lots of transitions between light and dark, between the snow and the rock, and the snow and the rock, and the snow and the rock, your eye already expects there to be big color transitions between white and black. And so it's okay to have a very narrow blending function between those two places. You're just not going to be able to see it anyway. So what NBLEND does is it uses this multi-resolution technique, and you get the best of both worlds. You get both a nice smooth sky and also no artifacts in the regions where there are these sudden transitions. So how does this work? Basically, what it does is it breaks down your input images based on the spatial frequency components. So you'll have the image on the left, all the edgiest edges will be in this top level of this frequency breakdown. And as you go further down this stack of images, you keep reducing the resolution more and more until what you're left with at the bottom here is only the really big, smooth things like the sky and very general features like that. And you repeat this process for the same thing on the right image, and then you have your blending mask between them. So the edgy edges up here get blended together with a really sharp mask. And then as you go down to things which are more coarse-grained, like the sky and big clouds and things like that, you use a more and more blurred mask between those things. So then you just merge all this stuff together and then collapse it back up again, and you're left with an output image which uses this multi-resolution technique. Okay, so this is kind of what that looks like. I exaggerated all of the contrast and the brightness here, so you can see that this level of the pyramid, this edge image, just has basically all the really fine details. And as you go further on down the stack of images, you get to things like the clouds and more coarse-grained objects that appear in there. Okay, so the NFuse tool is going to apply the same trick. It's going to use this multi-resolution technique so that you can't see where one image starts and the other image ends. The only difference is how it makes this blending mask. Instead of having a nice black on one side, white on the other side, it's going to make a much more complicated blending mask. So this one says that all of these pixels out here are nicely exposed and they have high weight, but the stuff in the window is overexposed, so that has black. It means it's not weighted very highly. And this image up here, the stuff in the window is nicely exposed, so that shows up in the mask. And basically what this is going to do is it's going to use the same multi-resolution technique, and you can't tell where the transition is between the nicely exposed wall and where this picture starts to come in and shows you what's outside the window. So mainly it's just a difference of how you design the mask for that. Okay, so the core part of the talk then is I'm going to go into somewhat of what are the interesting technologies that this tool uses to make it fast, and some of the clever tricks that it plays. Okay, so the first one is how we speed up the math a lot. So part of doing this image pyramids and building image pyramids and then merging them together and reducing them again is you end up doing a lot of filtering style operations. So one thing you need to do is you need to take this high resolution image and turn it into a blurred lower resolution image. And we do that by applying a filter. And basically what you do is for each output pixel here, you want to take a weighted average of a whole neighborhood of pixels in the source image here. And then when you scoot over to the next pixel here, effectively you're going to move this point over, and then what you'll end up doing is you'll end up reading all these data values from memory again. Most of them will all be the same. You'll have like the same set of 20 plus 5 new ones off on the right side here. And so this is a rather complicated memory access pattern. We'd like to be able to improve this, so that when we have billions and billions of pixels in your gigapixel image, you can still do this with a fair amount of efficiency. And so what the technique is used is called SKIP-SM, and this is it's an acronym for separable kernel image processing with state machines. And that's kind of a complicated way of describing something which is effectively just using scratchpad memory. So what this technique does is it does all the processing in exactly one pass over the input. And the idea is that you're scanning across the pixels here in your input, and by the time you get down to this one here, you've seen enough of the input image that you know how to compute this output now. You've seen the entire window of input pixels that you need to compute this. And so it's going to, as it walks along here, it's going to keep filling in these pixels that are shifted over to the left by 2. So here's kind of what that does. It uses a little bit of scratchpad memory to make this efficient. So as you scan across here, you look at the last 5 things you had, and you calculate the appropriately weighted average of those, and you store that in some scratchpad memory called A. And then you keep doing this as you go. So you go down to the next row, you remember these 5, and you put that in a variable called B, and so forth and so on. And finally, you get down to the end here. And now once you've read these 5 pixels, now you have enough data values that you can compute the final answer for this entry in the result image. And now that you have this, now you can put this in A and throw away the old value of A. and it just keeps marching on down the line. So this is a big speed up for doing this, because we're now iterating over the input image exactly once per each pixel, and the memory access pattern is really trivial. You're just going row by row by row. There's no looking in a window of pixels and then looking at the next window of pixels. Everything works out quite efficiently. Okay, so another interesting part about Nblend is how it actually makes the masks. So again, you have some green image and some red image. They overlap in some arbitrary way, and you want to come up with what is the seam line you should use to blend between those two images. So the way this works is we do a nearest feature transform in order to get this done. So I have the intersection region here, and then there's the region which is outside of the union. So this is like the inverse of the union of the two input images. And it's going to fill in, for each pixel in this area, it's going to say, what am I closer to? Am I closer to green or am I closer to red? So the white area means I'm closer to one of these green areas than I am to the red area. And the black pixels mean I'm closer to the red area than I am to the green area. Okay, and there's a couple interesting papers about how to do this efficiently. The algorithm that Nblend uses right now is not particularly efficient, but I am hoping on improving that later on. Okay, there's one more thing you got to do when you make the mask, is that you'll be taking your pictures and you'll come back to the computer later and you find out the one picture you really need to make your panorama great has been corrupted by some pesky tourist who got in the frame and wouldn't move. And you need to get them out of there. Like if you blend these together as is, you're gonna end up with half a guanaco, and people are gonna wonder why there's like this phantom thing in there. So, you know, if you look at the difference in these layers in the GIMP or something like that, you'll end up with, you know, you can obviously see that there's something wrong here. And what you really want to do is make the mask line kind of skirt around this. And this turns into somewhat of a difficult computer vision problem, because how do you know whether the guanaco really should be in the picture or not? And do you want to make the line go around this side of them or around this side of them? And what's the best way to do that? So I'll admit I don't have a particularly great answer for how to do this. I'll tell you what I implemented, and if you want to try it out, you can see how well it works on real images. So basically what I do is I start with the nearest feature transform. I use that as an initial solution, and that gives me a line that scoots down through the middle of the overlap region. And what I do is I model this as a polyline. I'll put some vertexes down on it, and I'll just set them to be some arbitrary distance apart based on how coarse of a solution I want to get for this. And then I'm going to draw some parallel lines here, or these are actually perpendicular lines, sorry. And this will describe the space along which I'm going to allow this vertex to move. And then I'm going to apply an annealing algorithm to this and let it find a solution for these vertices, which tries to avoid all of the terrible area here where this guanaco lives. So effectively, it has a cost function that says, don't let the line cut through this area of inequality between the images. And it's going to move the vertices along their constrained degrees of motion in order to try to optimize this. And then the last step is then I fill in the space between the vertices using a shortest path algorithm, basically Dijkstra. And that gives you it's a two-pass approach. Effectively, the annealing is doing a coarse approximation of what the answer should be, and then the shortest path algorithm fills in anything the annealing didn't particularly come up with. Okay, so that gives you a good seam line between the two. Third trick that Nblend does a lot is it takes into account color management. So we do a lot of math like this, where you have some RGB value and a second RGB value, and you want to blend them together using some linear blending. And if you simply do this using basic math, if you treat these as vectors and you add them up, you will get strange color disturbances, because the regular RGB color space is not it's not very perceptually uniform. And so if you have some bright colors like this and you try to blend between them, you'll end up with some strange darknesses in the intermediate area. If your images have color profiles embedded in them, then Nblend is able to use that and will apply a more complex blending algorithm that takes into account how your eye actually sees colors. And this is the CCAMO2 color appearance model. And so if you're willing to spend the time and actually pay the cost of the extra math, then you can get some better results. Yes?
Quick question.
Mm-hmm.
So to do that, you need
Oh, wait for the microphone, please. Yes.
So to use a color appearance model, you need not just the profiles, but you also need to know the viewing conditions and usually a bunch of other stuff. CCAM goes quite a bit beyond normal color management.
Yes, it
so
does.
How are you handling that?
I have hard-coded defaults, which is standard D50 viewing conditions, imagining that someone's eventually going to want to print this out or view it on their monitor. And in honesty, this does not make a very big difference in the final result for regular photographs, because you seldom have, you know, areas of bright purple and bright green that you need to blend together and make it look realistic. So, you know, if you're in a place where you're taking a panorama and there's lots of neon lights or something like that, which are changing colors, and you want to make sure those neon lights look really great, then sure, turn this on and get every last bit of correctness out of it that you can. In general, you're not going to see any tremendous amount of difference. But this is a lot of fun to implement this and learn about how color management works, because it's a very deep topic and has lots of intricacies in it. Okay, and the last thing I'd like to mention is that NBLEND needs to do lots of complex memory management as well. So people like to make these billion pixel panoramas, and once you see how much data you need to store as intermediate data here and take into account that all of these promote the bit type for the math you want to do. So if you have 8-bit input images, you want to have more than 8 bits of accuracy for all these intermediate computations. So these are now all 16 or even 32-bit fixed point format, and these pyramids, which reduce by a factor of 2 in both X and Y on each step, that gives you a series which adds up to 4/3. And you have the mask, you have the left image, you have the right image. This turns into lots and lots of bytes per pixel and the output that you want. So you could easily exceed the 4 GB address space of a 32-bit machine. I don't own a 64-bit machine yet, unfortunately, so I haven't had an opportunity to play with that. But what you can do is, we paid a lot of attention to making sure that all of the algorithms that NBLEND uses have very nice memory access patterns, that they scan across the images row by row, top to bottom. They don't do any random accesses to the memory. And so I do some of my own memory management. So there's some data structures in here which attempt to manage the storage of all these image data for us. So basically there's a data pool which stores chunks of images, and all of the code that you write will have an iterator that you use to access the memory. So this is a nice generic programming modular software architecture. And when you access data through one of these iterators, it's going to go out and say, is the data you're trying to access actually loaded into memory or not? And if it's not, it's going to tell this director of this cache to do a swap. It's going to go out the disk, load in some memory from a temporary file that it's made, decide if someone needs to get swapped out, who should get swapped out based on what image you know you're going to need to access next, and so forth. And so this is basically a transparent API on top of the Vigra library, which we use to do all of the math. And you don't need to know when you write the algorithm whether your image is one of these kind that uses the pool or just a regular image that goes into memory directly. And basically you get the full benefit of a nice transparent API from doing that. Okay, so this works out pretty good. I think that's all the slides I have on NBLEND and NFuse. And I'd be happy to answer any questions that anyone has about it.
So if I got it correct, the Gaussian blend is basically a running average through a window?
Can you repeat that, please?
So when I look at the Gaussian blend, it looks like running average through a window. And so what the question is have you given any thought to doing the computations on a high-end graphics card?
I have. The first thing I attempted to do was to move the seam line optimization onto the graphics card. So I had mixed success with that. I had a fairly old graphics card at the time, which didn't work particularly quickly for this kind of stuff. Basically, what I had done is I had taken the annealing algorithm that this uses, and what that does is it computes lots of exponentials and the delta cost of one choice for this coordinate versus another choice. And I put that math on the graphics card. So all the iterative solution would run on the GPU and use all the fragment shaders on the GPU to speed up all that computation. And I had mixed luck with that. I hadn't yet learned completely how to do math on the GPU properly. And it's obvious from the type of filtering operations that we do that some of this other stuff would work well on the graphics card as well. So doing this kind of math works nice on a sequential processor. It's designed to have a nice memory access pattern. Doing this on the GPU, you would just do it the other way. You would use a standard filter where you can compute each output pixel in parallel, and you get much faster results from that. One issue, of course, is how do you deal with the enormous size of the data set? And that is a serious problem for the GPU, because getting data back from the GPU onto the CPU is very slow. So it helps if you can send out all the data that you need to work on, do all of the processing on the GPU, and then after it's all done, load it back in. And it's not immediately clear how to do that for NBLEND, since we need to work on such large data sets. I think that you'll end up doing a lot of back and forth, and you'll kill any potential benefit that you would have gotten from doing that.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Especially regarding this slide, you mentioned that you have those four or five buffers, mm-hmm. A, B, C, D. What's not clear to me is, do you have these buffers for each column of the
pixels? Yes, you do. Yeah. So each of these buffers is the full width of the image. So effectively, the cost of this in Scratchpad space is four rows of the image. And
okay.
Of course, by the time you get here, you can start overwriting the top one, so you have this rotating buffer.
Okay.
So you can do some more tricks on this as well. If you look at the paper here, if you're familiar with how wavelet transforms work and you have these integer lifting schemes, there's some tricks you can play to reduce the amount of multiplies you actually need to do. And there's some, it's pretty clever, but I'll let you look at the paper if you want to understand how to do that.
Okay, and I have another question regarding the shifting of the separation line.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that you use a shortest path algorithm to fill in the gaps,
mm-hmm.
but it's not clear to me where do you get the points to do the shortest path algorithm on.
Yeah, the starting and stopping points are simply the solved vertices from the previous part of the optimization. So the annealer figured out where these points should be, and then the shortest path fills in between them. So one thing that people will typically do is you'll have a full 360 panorama, and so there will be some patch on the top that you want to fill in straight above you. And so you can easily end up with a case where you have sort of all the images around and then one patch to fill it in. And so you'll end up with a seam line, which is a closed curve. And so that becomes a little tricky to encode into a standard shortest path dynamic programming approach.
Oh, I'm not sure if, you have those red dots
yes.
there. So are you saying that the shortest path algorithm actually is done between these red dots, or your illustration suggests that there are more dots in between, which I don't know where they come from.
Yeah, so the shortest path is looking at this difference image.
Okay.
Right? And it's using this as the starting point and this as the stopping point, and figuring out exactly which pixels I want to cut through.
So, and you wipe the transitions between the pixels by the difference image. Okay.
Right.
I get that.
Thanks, very nice talk. I was just curious, how big of an image can you handle? How big a data set?
You can get quite big. I've done a gigapixel myself. So, and that was a 16-bit image as well. So that's 2 bytes per each channel, and I think it was 1.2 billion pixels. And that was basically a test to make sure that it's capable of handling that the image cache is working correctly. And it takes a bit of time to process that. It was probably like 2 or 3 hours on a Pentium 4 machine to do that. And most of the time is, of course, spent swapping back and forth between the disk. So with some more sophistication in the caching structures and maybe making it multi-threaded, you can hide some of that latency. Any other questions? All right, thank you.
Thank you.